Everyone loves a good whodunit, and true crime series are certainly making a killing on the small screen, from Making a Murderer to The Staircase. The latest is called Dirty John, and it stars one of our best homegrown superstar actors.
Eric Bana had the nation in stitches in Full Frontal. He continued his comedy streak in The Castle.
I had this one channel, kickboxing, 24 hours a day.
Proving he could also be taken seriously, he received the AFI Best Actor Gong when he portrayed criminal-turned-author Mark Chopper Reed.
All I can tell you is what I've already told Mr. Beasley. None of us saw anything. It was just one of those things.
Hollywood came knocking, and the Melbourne-based actor was offered huge roles in big-budget films.
I've seen this moment in my dreams.
I'm Deborah.
I'm John.
Now Eric has become the latest big-screen actor to star in a small-screen series. In Dirty John, he plays a true-life con man and sociopath who tore one family's lives apart.
You should enjoy the time left. That's what's going to come down to.
Please welcome Eric Bana.
Welcome to Studio 10.
Thank you.
This is an incredible series. Of course, it came from a podcast, Dirty John. Did you listen to the podcast?
I did, yeah. So the podcast was based on a real crime, and it was put together by a journalist from the LA Times, Chris Gofford, and the podcast was a phenomenon. And so my agent called and said, they're turning this into a mini-series if you're interested. Listen to it in one go, pretty much the whole thing, and I was like, I want to do this.
I was obsessed with the podcast, and when I heard you and beautiful Connie Britton, either now from Nashville or from Friday Night Lights were taking on the two main roles, I was just thrilled pink. And the series is everything you hope. It is so good. I've been binging. Now, you, of course, play Dirty John Meehan. He's charming. He's the perfect date until we find out otherwise. Yeah. How did you get inside his head?
I just did a lot of research into what these characters are like. I mean, obviously, there's a lot of information about the real John Meehan available to me, but it was important to me to try and capture the essence of what these manipulative, psychopathic, sociopathic characters are like. So that's what I really concentrated on.
Yeah. Eric, for you, I'm obsessed with sociopaths, as in how their brains work. You know, I think
you probably work with a lot of them over the years.
Yeah, we're on TV. We've got a long show. No, but in regards to how you, as Ange said, what are some of the telltale signs? Did he have a difficult childhood? What do you think turned him into this absolute sociopath?
Yeah, he did, and it's really interesting. You know, when you're researching these characters, because you're trying to find, you know, points of relevance and things to empathise with and so forth. But I also figured out that John Meehan is probably one of those guys that if someone had got him into therapy, he could have been in therapy for 30 years and never figured it out. You know what I mean? So I think it's a combination of things. In the end, I think he was really addicted to chaos. Chaos surrounded his whole life. And I think we all know those people who just... quite a lot of people who just like a lot of madness around them and drama and so forth. And he was a very, very complicated but highly manipulative, very good at what he did, and ultimately met his match in Deborah and her family.
Now, Deborah, of course, met John in online dating.
Yes.
How's this going for the online dating industry? How much are they loving this?
Well, I don't know. At first I thought it would put people off, but I think people would watch a show like this and go, oh, I'll have a dabble, you know, I'll be OK. And that was what turned the podcast and this story into a bit of a phenomenon, is not just what John does and how bad he is, but it's the way that Deborah responds to John, and that's what freaks people out a lot, because they can't imagine how someone can stay in that relationship once they understand how bad he is. But this sort of thing happens in real life. Deborah was a very intelligent, highly successful woman, and
beautiful.
These guys know what they're doing, you know? And there are a few red flags. I learned a few things along the way that perhaps people could look out for.
Such as?
Men wearing cargo shorts is one. here's one. In all seriousness, a very intricate backstory that can't be substantiated by anyone in the present.
Yeah.
So they're from out of town, you know, something happened to the parents, something happened to the brothers and the sisters. There's always a really complicated, well-constructed story, but no one around right now to substantiate it.
Yeah, you know? Right. And so, also, if you allegedly work in a hospital but you turn up to just about everything wearing your scrubs, a black tie dinner, wherever it is, you've still got them on.
Yeah, and for people who listen to the podcast know what you're talking about, one of his fronts was he claimed to be a doctor and so forth, and he would get around in scrubs out of work hours just to keep the ruse up. So I was quite excited when we got to the wardrobe section and there were my scrubs waiting for me.
Eric, you mentioned before, which is really true, Deborah was a highly intelligent, well-educated person and she fell into his trap of lies and manipulation. How does that happen, do you think? Is it playing on her insecurities?
I don't know if it's insecurities, but I think she's a very warm, loving, open person who was looking for love. She'd been married a few times before. And I think these guys know how to target particular types, and it's always a mismatch. The male in this case is very manipulative and experienced and knows what they're doing, and the partner is just trying to see the goodness in someone. So, you know, it is very complicated, and hopefully, and we've had the feedback from it airing in America has been massive. The show was huge, but a lot of good has come out of it as well. There's a lot of people who are now feel more comfortable saying something to their girlfriends about potential, you know, nightmare partners and so forth. And it sort of empowered a lot of people to actually say something.
Because her daughters tried, you know, they were sort of Nancy Drew doing the investigation sort of thing. What I found interesting is that Deborah decided to initially do the podcast and be so open about everything because part of that would have been quite humiliating for her that she had been deceived in this way. Did you get to meet Deborah? Because you're, of course, executive producer of this as well. Did you get to meet Deborah and sort of talk through why she wanted to go public with it?
Connie had a close relationship with Deborah in the pre-production and during the production. I decided to not meet with Deborah until we'd wrapped for various creative reasons.
Sure.
And sometimes you want to know absolutely everything about the person you're playing, and other times you're trying to come up with something different. So I didn't meet Deborah until after we'd wrapped, and then I met Deborah and Tara Newell and the daughters. And it was wonderful to finally meet them. And when I met Deborah, she was like, I'm not sure whether to hug you or slap you.
And which means you did a great job.
Hopefully. And the daughters, one of them was, you know, literally quite terrified when we met. And then I started talking and she said, oh, the Australian accent really helped her to kind of like disconnect. And she was fine once I started talking. But, so it wasn't until after the production.
Speaking of Australian accent, is it true that there are a lot of people in America who still don't realise you're Australian?
Oh, tons.
Really?
Yeah, all the time. Yeah, they have no idea that I'm Australian or they think you're British or... Yeah, absolutely.
And you've been able to achieve that rare thing of living here, of really still basing yourself here, yet working there. How have you managed to do that? So many give up the fight and flight syndrome.
Well, I think you have to. I mean, if you were doing serious television, you'd have to, but I've worked in film for over 20 years and there's no home. You're always somewhere different. I haven't shot something in LA for 9 years. This is the first production we'd done there for a long time. You know, you're in the UK, you're in Europe, you know, so there really is no base that makes sense. So to me, it's always most practical thing is to stay at home. So
now I've got to ask about one that is going to have you filming at home, and that is The Dryer. You are Aaron Falk. Wow, I loved this book. So many people loved the book, and we love that character. How much are you looking forward to it? Where are we at? When does it start?
We're in pre-production right now. I'm really excited. I think it's a great adaptation. Working with my dear longtime friend Robert Connolly, who's directing, and The Dryer was a phenomenon here in Australia, and much beloved by many book clubs around the country, and we hope to do a faithful adaptation. We're really excited about it. Our locations are amazing. I'm not going to tell you where they are, but it's going really well. We're in some interesting parts of countryside of Australia, put it that way.
Eric, we saw in the package earlier, this is your life, it was a bit of a package there before. I'm talking about Chopper Reid, absolutely loved you playing that character. Are you still fascinated that the whole Melbourne underworld controversy is still unfolding? We even saw the stabbing with Tony Mockbell.
Just goes on and on, doesn't it?
Yeah.
I know, it is amazing. And Australians have always had a bit of a fascination with it. And it's a difficult one because obviously, I was very close to it back then. I tend not to obsess with it so much on a day-to-day basis, but obviously back then I did a very deep dive and learnt a lot about it. But, it is both New South Wales and Victoria seem to have this, you know, incredibly complicated
underworld.
Yeah.
Yeah, and I think we'll still be making movies about them long into the future. Dirty John drops on Netflix today.
Valentine's Day viewing.
Is that a
I think it was deliberate.
Yeah, I think it was.
I think it's you know, for those who haven't got a partner or maybe you're not on speaking terms, you can kill 8 hours in one shot tonight.
It is a binge. It is very hard to stop watching. Congratulations.
Thanks very much.
You've done such a terrific job.
Eric Bana, you are absolutely brilliant.
Thank you
so much.